Welcome to Tech Brain Talk with your girl Flavella Fongang, and today I'm going to fuel your brain with some bomb knowledge. Are you ready? Let's do it. Hey everybody, welcome back for another episode of Tech Brain Talk, and I'm super excited because today we're going to be talking about how having a clear vision, and I love talking about vision, can help you create innovative and disruptive tech product, if I can pronounce the name of my title. Yes, so how having a clear vision can help you create innovative and disruptive tech product. And I think nowadays we've realized, you know, through the situation that we're going through right now, technology is so important to keep us first working, connected, and obviously do things a bit better, you know. And I'm so lucky because today I have Mary McDonald. And Mary is a highly experienced technologist, woo-hoo, and innovator. Mary has a love and aptitude for problem solving, which she has applied to the technology and insurance industries for the last two decades. You know, it doesn't sound like he's a very old man, but this man is really young and still full of life.
You're too kind, Flavella. Thanks very much for having me here today.
My pleasure, Mary. I want people to know more about you. I fell in love, you know, during our previous talk, and I want people to know who you are and why you're so fabulous. So tell us about your journey. What led you to what you're doing right now?
Yeah, sure, Flavella. So, I'm an immigrant here in the UK from South Africa. I came over here just over 20 years ago now. And as you rightly said, had a real passion for fixing things and solving problems and all that sort of stuff. And I found technology was a great way of doing just that. I started off working in a financial services company, working with a guy by the name of Robert Smithson. And we worked really well together. This financial services company was a equity research business. And what that basically does is gives investors industry kind of research and knowledge about the technologies and about the actual companies that implement these technologies. Moving on from there, I decided to really get stuck into technology and work for two technology companies, primarily focusing in on how to make businesses more efficient and just work better. Before then, trying to apply that to the industry where I thought that was most applicable to, which was insurance. Mm-hmm. And so worked at two insurance companies, trying to solve all their problems, trying to change their businesses from the inside out, before realizing that's actually a really, really, really difficult thing to do, you know, changing this kind of culture inside of an industry which, you know, traditionally has been very resistant, yes, to change and being really, really, really difficult. And mm-hmm. I guess that's kind of led me to where we are today, which is a really exciting new venture that I founded with Robert Smithson, the same Robert Smithson that I work with more than 20 years ago now, to really try and take on and change an industry that, you know, we believe, you know, is ripe for change and has been really ignoring the needs of many people for a very long time.
Yes, that's a very, very valid point. And, you know, it's funny because when you mentioned that some industries are very, reject or resistant to change, do you think that it's more related to the fact that there's a higher risk of failure or a higher risk of damaging their brand, or just think that this is the way things are being done and we just reject the idea?
That's a brilliant question, Flavella. I think that you're absolutely 100% right about that fear of failure, but I think it goes a little bit more than that. So I think that you're right. I think that, you know, in established companies, a lot of people, I'm not talking about the companies themselves, just people in general, inside of these companies, there is a culture of don't fail, don't make a mess up. And if you do, you're in for the high jump, basically. Mm-hmm. And there is so much, you compare that to a typical type startup mentality, which is embracing of failure and embracing of learning, because through failures, you can learn a lot. I can tell you that from personal experience. I can show you. But I think it's also this kind of protectionism as well of revenue and business, right? A lot of insurance companies, and I think this is true for a lot of other industries as well, I might add, I'm picking on insurance a little bit here, but for a lot of businesses, the fear of losing income that you already have is mm-hmm. quite real. And I think particularly in the very interesting times that we're finding ourselves like in now, I think a lot of businesses are having to really come to terms with this because we'll kind of explain this. I'll give you an example. Yes. One of my friends, he has a very, very innovative company down in South Africa. This company is all about selling secondhand cars online, very much like Auto Trader. In fact, they are Auto Trader's leading competitor in South Africa.
Wow.
They decided that they were reaching a kind of a saturation point in South Africa and were considering going to some other market. They chose a particular country. And as they were kind of brainstorming about, you know, what to do, they found it was kind of like an opportunity to try a whole bunch of new things. And the things they were coming up with were utterly amazing. And my friend, the CEO, who all of a sudden he realizes, hold on, why aren't we trying to do this sort of stuff in our home market, in our normal business? Mm. And he realized that even though they were a young, very dynamic company, for when they were getting in regular revenue, no one wanted to disrupt that. They just wanted to kind of leave that business kind of running because that was everyone's paycheck at the end of the month. And I think it takes a real bravery to try and disrupt that, the stuff that we know works, right? Mm-hmm. And if you have a look at insurance, it's just amplified like a million times, right? A lot of insurance companies are really successful. Why do we need to change something that we think works already, right? Why do we need to, break the mold when we're really making money? Mm. Well, the answer is, of course, that there, even though you may be making money, even though you kind of carrying on and so on, you never know what's going to happen, like COVID. I think this is what I was trying to say here, is that a lot of companies are really coming to the reckoning. I mean, my view was that every business in the modern world is a digital business. But with COVID hitting now, I think a lot of business leaders are realizing that actually their business should be a digital business. It's not. And now they're needing to change their business very, very rapidly to sustain themselves.
Yes, that is so, so true. And I think, it's one thing I've always say, talking from a branding point of view, because that's obviously where I focus, is as your company culture should always integrate innovation. Because for a moment that you get, put to a position where you're too comfortable, that's where you expose yourself to some risk. And especially as you explained, in the financial sector, a lot of fintech have come in and disrupted the market. Brings us back to the title of this, the subject is how to do it the right way, really. Because when you can bring tech for the sake of tech, but actually it doesn't solve any problem, what's the point? So for companies who are not there, who haven't, this disruptive approach, or maybe for tech companies who've been there for a long time and haven't innovated that much, so what would you say to them and what they should really do?
Well, again, Flavilla, as always, great, great insight. Knowing kind of what to do is the key thing there. And, a few years ago, I had an epiphany and it all started off when I read a book. In fact, I read two books and they kind of changed everything. And I would highly recommend your listeners to go and read these same two books. The books are The Lean Startup by Eric Ries and Running Lean by Ash Murray.
Love it.
And these two books, we will put the links down in your description section below, of course. But these two books really help to kind of like lift the veil on how to really approach these sorts of things. And that's how to really be a startup, change the way that you've done things. And it's certainly a thing that I kind of struggled with to start off with as well. And it kind of all comes back to exactly as you were saying, what is the problem that you're trying to solve? Because the worst thing you can do, of course, is build something that nobody wants. And you've wasted all this resources and money and everything else and time in particular. Time is the most important resource, of course, for something that no one actually works. So kind of giving an example of this, and I'm going to use like our business because we followed this kind of lean methodology. Mm-hmm. And basically the lean methodology kind of follows these three main stages. Number one is problem solution fit. So what does that really mean? What that really means is that you need to really understand what the problem is that people are actually facing. And then you need to hypothesize a solution. And this is the real critical bit.
Yes.
Test that. Listen. Mm-hmm. Change. Test. Mm-hmm. Listen. and continuously go through the cycle of testing this hypothesis until you find something that really resonates with a large portion of people. And mm-hmm. the key thing there is understanding quite clearly what is the problem that we're solving or what is the solution that, you know, could potentially solve that. That kind of leads into the second phase, which is the product market fit, which is, you know, you actually going and building something. Again, following the same sort of principles. So mm-hmm. once you build something as small as you can, testing it with real customers. And it's not just the actual product itself, it's pricing, it's the whole business. Listening, seeing what comes back, changing, testing again, listening, going through that cycle and doing these sorts of things before you reach the third stage, which is the scaling stage, right? Where you actually start to distribute your product or service a lot and try go for that hockey stick curve that a lot of startups, you know, wanting to go for. But critical thing there is not trying to scale like too early. So again, example from our own company, right? So, you know, we had an idea after, you know, Robert had moved, my business partner had moved across to LA some years ago, and he compared what, you know, our experience of car insurance here in the UK is to America. And we realized that actually the US was quite a way behind in certain things, you know, and there were certain indicators that proved that out. So here in the UK, less than 1% of people don't have car insurance if they have a car. In America, it's more than 13%, more than 1 in 8.
Crazy.
And in real numbers, that's more than 35 million vehicles are uninsured on American roads. That's an astonishing figure, right? And the question is, of course, why? Why is that the case? So to try and figure that out, we spoke to people. We set up user groups. We spoke to friends and family. We even went out to secondhand car dealers, you know, a whole bunch of them, spoke to those business owners, spoke to their customers and so on, and really with a large group of people tried to understand what the actual problem was. We then went a little bit further and started to test out, okay, what would the solution look like to solving that problem? And we found out things like, okay, one of the reasons why there was this large portion of people is public transport. Public transport in America is not anywhere near as widely available as it is here in Western Europe, which means that, yes, that if you wanting to go to work, you have to get in your car and drive. That's number one. Number two is car insurance in America is ridiculously expensive compared to here to in the UK. Mm. Number three is that a lot of folk from lower income backgrounds or, you know, lower income group were actually being avoided by insurance company. And that wasn't to do with insurance companies thinking that these people were any less safe. It had much more to do with what credit risk they posed. So that was really kind of like, in our example, you know, three of the major problems. And going down into a little bit there, you know, how can we actually solve that? Well, you know, a lot of our customers, they didn't have steady incomes and were much more comfortable paying for services such as electricity or their mobile phone bills on a pay-as-you-go type basis, just like a cell phone pay-as-you-go system and so on. So if you had a look at all the insurance products out there, all of them were very expensive monthly kind of subscription payments. And you know, there were serious implications to your credit score and so on if you missed one of those payments. So we thought, okay, well, if we offered a pay-as-you-go type insurance product, would that help? And that really resonated with a lot of folk. Other examples, insurance companies generally, you have to sign up to a long 12-month contract, mm-hmm. which scared a lot of people with them not really knowing if they are going to have a job next month or the month after, yes, right? So we offered a 30-day policy. Mm-hmm. We thought, okay, a 30-day policy is going to potentially help a lot of those sort of folk. And again, really, really resonated, right?
Yes.
And, you know, lastly, to try and take away that kind of risk around their credit score, we really thought, okay, well, what happens if we actually put people in control of how much they actually spend by, instead of trying to price that the person pays dependent on what credit risk they are. Instead, let's mm-hmm. change that to be how safely they actually drive being the determinant for how much they pay. And again, that really resonated a lot with our customers.
Mary, this is so, so innovative and disruptive because not only you, I think there's one thing that we, our brain is probably going to be numb, that we, because we live in a very globalized, especially in Western countries, it's a very globalization is one thing. We always think that the way we operate in the UK will be exactly the same thing. We take the assumption open banking as well, that every country have the same, every country has the same method in terms of, you know, around that, for example. And, you know, I think globalization has makes, you know, may have made our brain a bit numb in terms of, oh, it is because it is done such a way in my country when I assume that it's the same thing in another country. Yeah. And I think what is great about your approach, and obviously, because we haven't talked so much about just, you know, insure, which is with your business, you know, just insure, that's a, you know, that's Mary's business and it's obviously the founder, you should check it out, is really good, is that not only you've, you know, you brought innovation and disruption, but not in your country, in another country. It adds two layers of difficulty. You are not, first of all, physically always there, I'm presuming, and you tell me if I'm wrong. You know, you are based in the UK, and you also have to understand the behavior of a culture, what it means, and how I operate the system and everything else. And it creates a lot of challenges, right? And a lot of, obviously, resilience to make sure you do it right.
Well, I think, look, I think you're absolutely right. We actually have gone, I've gone into the weeds a bit about what we're trying to do without telling us, telling your audience what we're all about. So Just Auto Insurance is a car insurance company with a difference.
Yeah.
One that is fair, affordable and accessible to everyone. One that, charges you only when you actually use your car insurance, puts you in control of how much you actually spend. Without the need to sign up to any long, expensive contracts. And kind of moving like on to unpack some of the questions that you had there. I think this really comes down to one of the areas of real expertise for yourself, and that's brand. You know, we need to create a brand that people trust. You know, I think a lot of people, if they think insurance companies are evil and an unfortunate necessity that they need. And that's because of, you know, typical behaviors from insurance companies. We really want to provide a service that people can trust in. We want to be a business that clearly demonstrates that we want to be there for them, right? We don't view them with contempt like some other insurance companies appear to do. And how we want to do that is, of course, to understand people. And so on. So in terms of Just, yes, we have a UK arm. That's where I am at the moment. That is where we have our engineering and design team. The quality of these sorts of resources in the UK is absolutely world class, particularly being able to, you know, because London is the center of European innovation. We get, of course, the added benefit of being able to attract the best talent across the EU as well.
Yes.
We do have a US office based out of Los Angeles, and this is where our user research team is, for example. It's where our marketing team is as well. And, you know, this is how we, you know, I'm a firm believer, you do need to be close to your customer to really understand them, to get people are people. And, you know, you need to be close to someone, I believe, to really understand them so that you can just speak to them face to face, perhaps not in COVID times, you know, perhaps it's through a video call or we're with a mask on or whatever. It's important to really understand their circumstances. A good example of that is the first state that we are offering insurance in America is Arizona.
Oh, why Arizona?
Well, Arizona is quite close to California, of course, and it's the Department of Insurance there is really fantastic and open to really new innovative products. They know that they, you know, they're 13% of uninsured folk there. It's a little bit more in Arizona, and they really want to change that. They're also very keen on improving road safety, and this is another key thing that we are trying to do as a business, to really encourage people to drive more safely and therefore lower claims and improve the actual cost of the insurance as well. So they're really open to innovative new products. Waymo, Google's autonomous vehicle company,
yes,
and Uber, yeah, they've gone into Arizona as well, you know, first off to provide their offering. So Arizona's a good state.
Yeah, that sounds super exciting.
Yeah. So the point I was trying to make about Arizona and so on is, you know, coming from England, you know, okay, admittedly, today is a lovely blue, you know, English summer's day, which are some of the best in the world, of course. But, you know, typical, that's not our typical kind of weather, right? No. And in Arizona, it is incredibly dry. And there is, being very dry, you know, you can imagine, you know, Western movie, you know, with cactuses and a lot very like open, dusty landscapes. And, you know, for our product, car insurance, this is really important because, again, listening to our customers, the first question that anyone asks you from an insurance company in Arizona is, do you provide windscreen cover? Because with this dry weather comes stones. And with stones being flung up comes windscreen damage, right? And this is really, really important for them. The next question they'll ask you is, do you provide hail cover? So Arizona doesn't get, you know, a tremendous amount of rain. They have a kind of wet, kind of like a small wet season where there can be quite bad flooding and so on. But they'll get these massive storms where it'll just hail. And some of these hailstones can be small. Some of them can be very big and completely wreck your car. And, you know, these sorts of, you know, very local things really matter. And listening to people and understanding, again, what real-world problems that people are facing really can make a difference as to, you know, the success of your business as well.
Mary, I think you made some really, really valid point, especially in the world of the insurance sector, where companies have failed in general to really build a relationship with their customer and very much perceived as a commodity where every year you feel like you have to renew this. And it's not really something, you know, you don't choose to stay with the same company. You're looking for the best deal. And that's something that can really be changed. And I'm glad that we, you know, we talked about that. We're going to talk about more in the next seconds.